All right, let us start. Hi everyone, welcome to CMU Silicon Valley Distinguished Lecture Series. We are deeply honored to have one of the most influential scientists in the world, Professor Tamer Başar, and it is personally an honor for me to introduce him to you today. Professor Başar is the Svenland Endowed Chair and Center for Advanced Study Professor of Electrical and Computer Engineering at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, where he has been teaching since 1981. Professor Başar is a world-renowned control theorist with major contributions spanning the fields of optimal, robust, and adaptive control, large-scale and decentralized systems, stochastic control, estimation and information theory, security, trust, mathematical economics, and communication systems and networks. He has over 600 publications in all these fields, including several classical textbooks, and Professor Başar has numerous prestigious honors and awards, which I cannot list all here, but a few of them I will mention. He's a member of US National Academy of Engineering, a member of the European Academy of Sciences, and last but not least, he is a fellow of major institutions like IEEE, SIAM, and IFAC. Without any further ado, I would like all of us to thank Professor Başar for coming here, and we all look forward to his lecture.
Thank you very much, Osman, for the this invitation to deliver this lecture, and it's a pleasure to be here at the CMU campus in Silicon Valley. I had been to CMU Pittsburgh earlier several times, but had never been here, so this is a good experience. And so what I would like to talk about today is multi-agent network systems, and I'll bring adversarial elements into that framework, and part of the lecture will be on introducing to you this vast field and some of the outstanding issues that people have been, including my group at Illinois, have been addressing, and several other issues and challenges that remain. So in a sense, it's somewhat easy to describe what we mean by multi-agent systems. So here's the outline of my talk. I'll first share with you my view of multi-agent network systems. So the presence of multiple agents is one thing, and networking is another thing, and then the systems, of course, is yet another aspect of that. And as you can see from the outline, I'll introduce a graph theoretic framework for multi-agent network systems, describe it as a multi-layer graph with interdependences between different layers. And this brings in issues in sensing, communication control, and collaboration and coordination. And so multiple disciplines are actually involved in this line of research, and students generally have to have backgrounds in not only in control, but also communications and game theory, as well as signal processing to some extent. And I'll talk about opportunity decision making and how decisions can be timed if you have a limited number of opportunities. And then I'll talk about the challenges the uncertainty in the decision environment brings in, as well as the asymmetry in information when you have more than one agent. And then I'll concentrate in the second half of the talk on adversarial actions, the presence of adversaries in networks, in multi-agent systems, and particularly three different types of applications I'll talk about. One of them is the what I call opportunistic adversary, where the adversary breaks links, action links. And so therefore the controller, for example, cannot get the kind of performance that it's normally would expect without the presence of adversary. And I'll talk about as a second application, the control of information flow as well as disruption of information flow. And this has also applications in epidemics, for example, the spread of epidemics, as well as the in social networks, the spread of information and rumors and so on. And the last one is connectivity maintenance. When we have mobile agents, the mobile agents will be essentially the UAVs, unmanned aerial vehicles, as well as ground vehicles, terrestrial vehicles, and the adversarial aspects of formations in these problems. And then I'll conclude. So this is the outline of the talk. As I indicated, I first want to discuss what multi-agent network systems are. It's, in a sense, easy at some level of generality, quite easy to describe. You have agents that are connected in various ways, and these are heterogeneous agents. So there could be humans, there could be machines. So each one is an individual decision maker, and they are distributed over a network. Or there could be multiple networks, and as we'll see, and these networks actually interact with each other. And the agents interact with limited information, and this limited information is both online and offline. So there, it's not a centralized decision-making process. The information of each agent is localized in a sense, and that brings in many challenges, as we are going to see. And there is possibly conflicting objectives among the agents. So I mentioned the possibility of multiple layers, and you can think of at least three different layers in networks. One is the when the network nodes are agents, and then the links that connect the edges that connect the agents serve some purpose, and that purpose could be, for example, communication information. There could be information flowing from one agent to the other. You can have a bidirectional graph or a directional graph, which means that you have information flowing only in one direction. In the case of bidirectional, information could flow in both directions. So that's the communication and information network. And another network would be the collaboration network, which tells us, so the agents, if two agents are connected, then that means that these two agents collaborate in accomplishing a mission. And then there is the physical network that connects different subsystems together. And so if a physical network, if one link there breaks, then it means the two subsystems which were connected normally are no longer connected, they are disconnected. So there is, you can, see that that these are, even though these are separate networks and which I call multi-layered networks, there is interaction between them. For example, if the communication breaks down, then between two agents they may not be able to collaborate. So therefore, there is a strong dependency or interdependency between these different networks. So, again, as I alluded to, you can in the simplest form, but also in the most general form, you can describe multi-agent network systems as graphs. And the graphs are, there is a set of nodes, and there is also a set of links or edges which connect these graphs. I'm not going to talk about too much about graph topologies here and so on, but what I want to stress here is that normally in graph theory, the nodes are stationary, they are fixed, whereas the kinds of problems that we'll be dealing with will also open the possibility of the nodes being mobile. And so therefore the nodes could have their individual dynamics built into them. For example, you can view a node as a UAV, for example, as an aerial vehicle, which is controlled, and the control, the trajectories that UAV will follow could be restricted by the dynamics of that particular system. So the nodes are agents, but an agent encapsulates the possibility that they could be actually dynamic system in itself. So if you go deeper into, if you look into a node and the way the restrictions are imposed on the node, then that will give you a dynamic system. So you can do high resolution or low resolution aspects of this graph, and you obtain different pictures as far as the underlying structural properties go. So the links, as I indicated, could be one of three types: the connections, and these are the collaborations. So if I have two agents that are connected, then it means either I don't have color here, but in terms of different networks, but if these two agents are connected, this could be either a physical connection or a collaboration or a communication connection, which means that the agents share information either through a bidirectional link or a unidirectional link. So these are layered graphs. So I have already mentioned this communication, collaboration, and the physical aspects of this. Now, what this slide does is brings in the possibility that some of the nodes or agents could be adversarial. And so what does the adversary do? The adversary could jam the communication, for example, between two agents. The adversary could interrupt collaboration between two agents. And the adversary can, in fact, break physical links. And I'm going to discuss applications which actually go a little bit deeper into each one of these in specific context. So what that, when you bring in an adversary, so here the red nodes are the adversarial nodes, so which means that if a red node is connected to a blue node, it means that they are there is adversarial action there. This one could, for example, disrupt the communication between two different agents of blue nodes. So we have to live with this. You have intruders and eavesdropping and so on all the time when we deal with security problems in the network. There is always an adversarial element. So what that leads to, how to handle the presence of an adversarial element, and this leads to a game situation. Okay, so without an adversary, then you can view it as a single sort of an optimization problem, centralized or decentralized optimization problem. But when you bring in an adversary, we have a game situation, and when the goals are totally opposing, then we have a dynamic zero-sum game. So between these multiple agents. So in this scenario, for example, you can think of this as all the blue ones are the constitute a team, and they want to accomplish some mission. And then the red ones constitute another team, but which is adversarial to the blue ones. So you can view this as a zero-sum game between multiple teams, between two teams, and each team having either friendly agents or adversarial agents. Of course, one could have, this is as far as the objectives go, the communication between the agents while operating in this scheme could be decentralized. They may not share all the information. And the same thing, not only to find the blue notes, but also it applies to the red notes. So now the even if you have just blue notes or blue notes in the midst of red notes, the friendly notes and agents may have misaligned goals, but they are not directly opposing to each other. And this may arise because they have selfish interests, even though they are not opposing each other, or they have localized information. And this again leads to a game situation, but this is a broader set of games, the so-called non-zero-sum games. These are the types of games that John Nash started looking at in the early 1950s, late 1940s. And that's why the equilibrium concept here is named after him. So that's the Nash equilibrium concept. So generally, you can formulate these problems as dynamic non-zero-sum stochastic games, and the solution concept would be the Nash equilibrium. And the special case, what I had on the previous slide, where we have teams playing against teams as zero-sum games, could be viewed as a special case of this Nash equilibrium. There, the saddle point equilibrium is generally, in the case of zero-sum games, what one would be interested in, and that is saddle point equilibrium is a Nash equilibrium. Now, the Nash equilibrium itself, that's nice as an equilibrium concept, but it's generally inefficient. So when you have all these blue notes, which are which try to collaborate with each other, and they may have some selfish interests, but the question is, do we get the kind of performance that we would like to get out of the system if there was a centralized decision maker which tells them how to act? And that would essentially make them a team problem, but by putting different weights on their selfish interests or on their local objective function. Now, generally, Nash equilibrium, if there is a centralized decision maker, then performance that one obtains is better than what one would obtain using a Nash equilibrium. So this is known as Nash equilibrium being grossly inefficient, depending on the specific application. And there have been a lot of work on along the direction of what additional structure can we bring in to relieve the inefficiency, the disadvantage or degradation to performance that results due to inefficiency. And one way of overcoming that is to bring in another mechanism, and that is the hierarchical decision-making mechanism, and this is the mechanism design in economics and in control. There has been a lot of work, and particularly recent work in the context of smart grids and power networks, where you design incentives or pricing mechanisms where you incentivize individuals so that even though they are not sharing all the information, they end up acting as a team. Stackelberg equilibrium is a hierarchical equilibrium concept, and that's again something that is used in this context. So to remove the inefficiency or to relieve somewhat the negative impact of inefficiency, one has to bring an additional structure, maybe identify some of these nodes as the leaders. This is known as the leader-follower games. And you identify some of these blue notes as leaders, and they set policies, and essentially under these policies, the other nodes act in a way which aligns their goals. So there's a lot of work that has been done. I'm not going to discuss on mechanism design here. There is a Nobel Prize which was given for work in economics, which dealt with mechanism design. So let me talk about two applications, and I'll come back to these applications a bit later. One of them is the I mentioned this information spread, and here you have again the red nodes and the and blue nodes, and this has applications in social networks, in epidemics, and so on. And the question is, how do you limit the spread of misinformation? So let's say that the adversaries are injecting incorrect and deceiving information into the network. How do you limit that? Another way of looking at this is how do you bring in measures and countermeasures to limiting popularity of products and popularity of candidates in an election, for example. And the timing of these is important, and also controlling the flow of that information. So this could be the control could be for two different reasons. One is there is some adversarial impact on the network, and you have to break some of the links, for example, so that this misinformation is not going to flow over the network and affect other parts of the network, other nodes. Or in the context of epidemics, you actually do want to break some of the links, to isolate some of the nodes in order to prevent or decelerate the spread of disease. So the same theory that you develop actually could be used for positive purposes as well as for negative reasons. And so this whole thing is an interaction between an intelligent adversary and a dynamical network, what the individual nodes want to do, and then how the adversaries, the presence of the adversaries, are preventing the nodes to accomplish their mission. So I will have a specific model in some specific context, in the context of distributed averaging over networks, which we'll discuss in a little bit more detail, the optimization problem that is behind the development of policies here. And epidemics is another topic that we have worked on, and one of my students has written a PhD thesis recently completed, but I don't have time to go into that, but I'll give you a list of references where it can be found. So the second one, I talked about this application where the UAVs, a team of UAVs, want to accomplish a certain mission, and here the green ones are the friendly ones. They want to have a formation, for example, and then the red ones want to prevent the formation to happen. And so, in order to accomplish a mission, the green ones will have to be within some communication range of each other. And the red one will try to jam this communication. And note that there is mobility here. Each one is that there are two nodes, two friendly nodes, and one adversarial node, but they are mobile. And so therefore the mobility will come into picture, and optimal control theory or differential games comes into picture. So the jammer in this case will want to maximize the time for which the communication is jammed. If the communication is jammed or communication line is broken between the two vehicles in the fleet, then the objective of the adversary would be accomplished. But then on the other hand, the UAVs want to minimize that time. So you can see that a zero-sum game actually comes into play here, and you have to formulate this as a zero-sum differential game, in fact. So here is it's the same scenario, but this is an animation where after a certain period of time, the green ones have actually accomplished to get within their each other's communication range, and then this way to accomplish their missions. And I'll say more about this, the specific formulations for problems of this type. Now, coming back to the basics, all these problems, the starting point is a network control system. If you have just one agent or multiple agents, which can all be thought of as a controller for a system, this is what we have as the classical or standard control feedback diagram, and think of this as a link, direct link, wired link at this point to the C. Then this is a standard problem. Here is a plant you want to control, and there is an uncertainty that comes in from the environment. You say here is a sensor which looks at the state of the plant or some combination of the states of the plant, the output of the plant, and then sends it over a direct link, connected link to a controller, and then the controller applies its control signal to the plant, and the purposes would be some performance, optimization, or stability, or both. Now, more recently, this is something that goes back to the 1950s, 1960s in the state space framework. Now, more recently, about 10 or 15 years ago, because of driven by applications, people have started looking into problems where these connections are over networks. It could be wireless network rather than hardwired. So it brings in several other additional restrictions on the way you can operate such networks. And also the connection, the link from the controller to the plant is also over a network. And I'll talk about some of the restrictions or some of the challenges this operation over a network brings, but I will, this is a simple control, feedback control system. We are more going to talk about the multi-agent systems where the controller actually is replaced by multiple agents, but still the nature of the feedback there remains. That is, for any successful operation in a multi-agent system, you have to have information feedback. Decisions have to be based on the information that the agents receive, and that information, the decisions, will have to be fed back into the network. So the plant here will actually be the plant and control combination is going to be the network itself. So what does in the control context, what challenges this sort of a scenario brings? For example, you are operating, the controller is at a remote location than the plant. This one application was, for example, remote surgery, which has been remote gallbladder successful. Actually, stories have been told about the operator, the surgeon, being at one location, and in fact, there was one between New York and France, and the patient being in France, or vice versa. And the surgeon conducted a gallbladder operation over the internet, over the network. In that application, it was a dedicated network, but it's possible to do it over the internet also. So, but some of the challenges are when you design controllers for such systems is that, first of all, when you are connecting over a network, particularly a wireless network, you have delayed and unreliable transmission. So you have to take that into account. And so delayed and unreliable transmission in both directions, both from the sensors to the controller as well as from the controller to the plant. And then the control itself, it could be a battery-operated operation. You have limited memory. You don't have infinite computational power. And if the control has multiple components, each one may have access to different information. So the decentralized control is an important aspect of problems of this type. And the other thing is that, again, when we are operating in a battery operated environment, then you have to use the resources that you have sparingly. And for example, the sensor will have to communicate with the control sparingly only when it's necessary. So these lead to interesting problems as to how do you turn this phrase as necessary into an optimization problem. And every time you use, you do a transmission, either from the sensor to the controller or from the controller to the plant, you are using up some of the resources, for example, energy. And it could be depleted at some point, and you have to think of whether one has to, or the units have to think of whether the use should be now, or whether you should wait for an opportunistic moment in the future. So you have the sensors communicating with control sparingly, controller communicating with plant intermittently, and the adversary disrupting intermittently or flipping bits. Okay, so when the controller sends a control signal to the plant, then if there is an adversary, then you don't know whether the signal that is received by the plant is the signal that was intended to be sent by the controller. So now, with this scenario, so these are the issues that come up in network control systems. But what started with was multi-agent network systems, and you can view multi-agent network systems as a generalization of this network control system. But when you have multiple agents and you have mobility, where the controllers actually are the agents, they are the nodes that move around, and they may have conflicting objectives. Okay, but still the one element that remains here is that the feedback is important, information feedback, turning information that you receive into executable actions is an important thing, and that affects the information that is received in the future. And so that's the common element between these multi-agent network systems and the network control systems. And you, one has the kinds of issues that I discuss, like the unreliability of the channels, and then the adversary coming in and flipping bits, and so on, bandwidth constraints. They all show up in this framework also naturally. And you have one additional thing that comes up is that in multi-agent network systems, you have multiple objectives, as I have indicated earlier, where different agents could have different utility functions, cost functions, and depending on the nature of the problem, you have either Nash equilibrium or the stack of Buck equilibrium that one has to use. So the kinds of, this is a sort of a summary slide, the kinds of things that arise, the issues that arise in multi-agent network systems, is some of them as direct sort of outgrowth of the issues that arise in network control systems, is first of all, you have limitations on memory. And the second one is the information that's acquired by different agents are not the same. We call this asymmetry in the information. And there are limitations on computation and communication capabilities. There are resource constraints, which lead to some restriction on the number of times you can take actions, or the number of times you can make exchanges. The channels could sporadically fail, and they are heterogeneous. And you are operating in a hostile environment with adversarial actions, and you don't have necessarily cooperation among multiple decision units. There is lack of common objective that leads to a game scenario. And the last one is the importance of trust. And when you have human elements, the question is, when you are receiving information from another node that's in your neighborhood that you are connected to, do you trust that information? Do you trust that? And trust, it takes time to build trust. It takes time to learn who your neighbors are. And so therefore, there are models which show the evolution of trust for agents based on past actions and how those past actions have led to performance. And so therefore, that has to be built into the decision-making process on the part of the agents. So if you bring in trust, but I'm not going to discuss this here. There's the issue of also, this is a deeper issue, which is that of common knowledge. One of the Nobel laureates, Bob Ohman, had introduced this. Common knowledge is important if you want to formulate a precisely mathematically precise optimization problem or a stochastic team problem, which essentially says that if you have two agents, how much I know about the other agent, how much the other agent knows that I know about that other agent, and you can see that that goes to ad infinity. And where does this stop? So the common law knowledge is the limit of that operation, and that has to be brought in also because this uncertainty in not on what I know about some other agents, but on what they know about me and what I think they know about me. These are two different things. And the discrepancy between these perceptions would lead to a degradation in performance. And so that's, again, another important element that has to be built into this. So the general abstract framework is we have an uncertainty, we have an uncertain environment in these problems. We have decision makers, players, and agents. The perceptions of decision makers on the uncertainty, as I discussed, this common knowledge is an important thing. The objectives of the agents. One has to, for a precise formulation, one has to describe the interactions between the agents, and the underlying network actually does that, these multi-layer networks. And then there is the what information is common among the agents, what information is private. So that has to be made precise. So in as I indicated earlier, the information flow is important in these problems, and how you turn the information that you receive in executable to executable action is again important. So the decision makers pick policies, we call them decision laws, strategies. These are all interchangeable terms, and which lead to actions that evolve over time. So we have a dynamic decision making problem, and the policies are constructed based on the information that's received, which could be active information. That's active meaning what other agents have done, as well as passive. And these are guided by individual utility or cost functions over the decision-making problem. Now, there are, based on the structure of the underlying problem, if you have just a single agent or a single decision-maker, I'm going to use these interchangeably, then you have the stochastic control. And that's a fairly well-understood topic. And if you have a single objective but multiple agents, and they have different information, but their objectives, they all agree that they have a single objective, then this is the framework of stochastic teams. And there are still several open problems on existence. I'll mention some of them here, and characterization of solutions there. Otherwise, if you have multiple agents and you have multiple objectives, you have either a zero-sum, ZS stands for zero-sum, or non-zero-sum games, with Nash equilibrium being the solution concept, or the Stackelberg equilibrium if you have hierarchy in the decision-making. Now, some of these problems are difficult, some of them are easy. By easy, I mean the or simple, by I mean problems where we know how the only difficulty may be the computational aspects or characterization of the solution, but we know how to approach these. Whereas there are others which are quite difficult and for which a general theory is not available, but we have made significant progress in that domain recently. So this is a result of the coupling of information and actions. The question that I ask is the quality of the active and relevant information received by a player or an agent affected by actions of other agents? So if the actions of other agents influence the information that one agent receives, then this becomes a much more difficult problem to handle. For example, in dynamic decision making with a single agent, and when you have an objective function which is defined over a certain horizon, generally a dynamic programming is the right way to approach this problem. But when the actions of some players influence the information of other players which come, who will be making decisions later on, then that becomes dynamic programming fails. So if the answer to this question is yes, if the quality of the active, then it's a generally a difficult problem. And there have been issues, many challenges, existence of team optimal solutions in these problems, when the information content is dependent on the past actions. And the existence of Nash equilibrium in stochastic games, characterization of team optimal solutions, and the characterization of Nash equilibrium policies. So some of the challenges, and this is a sort of a deeper on the mathematical side of things, is that a solution may not exist. For example, there is a possibility of non-existence of solutions when you have asymmetry in information. There is this action, if the action influences the information of an agent who will be acting later on, action of some other agent, then there is this triple role of that action. Do you use your action in order to make the system behave better, improve the performance of the system, or do you use your action to signal information to some future agents on what you have seen about the environment? In other words, action has in this case triple roles, which is, you know, the caution, probing, and signaling, and it's the precisely capturing the relationship between these roles is what has been challenging to researchers working in this field. And then there is the signaling. You can use signaling for two things through your action. You can use it either to send information to the extent possible on what you have observed to future agents, relevant information, or one can use signaling in order to deceive agents in the future, or it could be used as a threat. And so whether you are working in adversarial situations or in team situations, the actions will have two different goals. So there is also this tension between signaling and optimization. So I'm not going to go any deeper. I just want to talk to you a little bit about the challenges involved in these problems. And one particular problem, and which is, this is the only slide that I have in telling you in specific terms what sort of difficulties arise. This is a stochastic control problem, which we say with non-classical information. It's one with limited memory. So this is a situation where you have two agents, A and B, and these agents make decisions based on what they receive. And note that in this case, the action of this first agent A is use zero. And this action goes over a channel and with some noise here is the only information that's received by this other agent. and then he decides on his action. So therefore, the information that this agent receives is affected by the action, the quality of this information about X, for example. This agent would like to know what X is and then would improve the performance, is affected by this action U. And here there is a cost function. This is a cost function, which is a function of X, U0 and U1. And the agents want to pick gamma 0, gamma 1, so as to minimize this quantity, expected value of this quantity. So this is a problem with limited memory in the sense that this agent who comes after B, who comes after A, who follows A, does not have access to all the information that A receives, particularly does not know X. Now, if I had a link from here to here, this would become a classical dynamic optimization problem, and one can use dynamic programming to solve this. But since this is not the case, this is a very difficult problem. This is a problem which was formulated actually in a specific instance of this, was formulated by Hans Witzenhausen in 1968, and who provided not a solution. The solution is still not known for that specific instance, but he showed existence of a solution to this problem. But extending this to other vector, these are all scalar quantities, to vector quantities and so on, has been a challenge over the years. There have been different ways of obtaining existence of solutions to this also specific problem. But more recently, we have actually develop an approach which applies to most of these problems with what we call non-classical information or asymmetric information, and I'll just leave you with these references. You can write to me if necessary. I can send you these papers, but we have been able to extend the existence of solutions to problems of this type, where you have limited memory, where you have multiple decision units, not only two units, but multiple, like relay channels. And anyway, so that's has been one success story of the recent years. And the student here, the Abhishek Gupta, completed a PhD thesis recently on this. And then we have with another, a former student of mine, Serdar Yüksel, we completed a book on this general stochastic network control systems, where we discuss stabilization, optimization, and bringing elements of information theory and communications and computations, and solving a number of problems which were not had not been solved until that. But it also provides a general sort of framework for stochastic network systems and stochastic team problems. So back to limited usage, limited action problem. So this is a slide that I had earlier, where the adversary disrupts intermittently or flips bits. And I'm going to formulate one class of problems. So the next, the remainder of this talk will have three applications. One is this limited usage action application from the adversary's point of view. The other one would be on breaking the links for information spread problems. And the other one is this connectivity maintenance for UAVs and terrestrial vehicles. So the common elements in all these problems, that when you have limited usage or limited action, so I'll give you just the bottom line, is that a decision maker or an agent is faced with the problem of whether you should take an action now, and think of it as you have a number of tokens in your pocket, a limited number of them, and every time you take a decision, you lose one of them. You have to give one of them. So if you use all of them and the number of tokens you have is fewer than the number of decisions times you have in your decision-making process. And so therefore you have to behave opportunistically, and that leads to a trade-off. The trade-off, the benefit of taking an action now to that of taking one in the future. When there is, but you don't know exactly what your action now is going to lead to, and what your action in the future is going to lead to. There is uncertainty there. But you have to trade off these in a probabilistic sense. And the ultimate goal is to have the best performance at the end, and you have this restriction on the resources. And there's one recent paper where we have looked into this in the context of sensor networks, where the sensors are spread. This is in a military context or in an agricultural context. This is an application that makes sense, where the sensors collect information from the environment, and they exchange this information with each other, and then they have to estimate some quantity, for example, the temperature, the average temperature of the soil. And now the thing is, they are battery operated, and in fact they could be solar. They could use solar energy, and there is uncertainty as to how much of the, every time they make a decision, they make a transmission, or they receive information, they use one unit of resource. And so in this case, the resource itself is not known, the amount of the resource, because it depends on the solar energy and whether you will be depleting the battery within three decision units or within five decision units is not clear. So that brings in the uncertainty. That's one of the uncertainty, and the other one is what you will be doing in the future. Anyway, so this is one application in the sensor networks, and the main thing here is that the information and decision making is not centralized, because you have these sensors which are making decisions in a decentralized way. And the other important thing is that if one agent is sending information to the other, and these are limited in terms of limited by the resources, if one agent does not send, make a transmission, that is still information to the other agent. In other words, if you tell me that you are going to give me a call, telephone call, if something happens and you don't call, if that doesn't happen, then if you don't call, you are not going to lose anything. But that's a message to me. Okay, that's a very simplistic example of this. So what makes these problems difficult and more challenging is this information content, information carried by inactions. Even inaction is useful. And so these are most of these problems lead to threshold-based optimal policies. So there is an event that's generated. And if a certain threshold exceeds, if the information that you receive exceeds a certain threshold, then you act. If it falls below a threshold, then you don't act. So the first time these types of problems were introduced and solved in some context, in the estimation context, was in this paper with again a former student of mine. So another class of problems is with limited usage, is when the adversary disrupts or jams communication, and I won't go into the details of the derivation. This again leads to threshold type policies, but here you can see that this is where the jammer comes in, an alpha sub k, where if alpha, and this is the control, so if alpha is zero, then there is no control input. So this is the problem where the jammer actually, or the adversary, I should say, it's not a jamming problem, the adversary breaks the link from the controller to the plant. So the controller cannot control the plant, cannot send a signal. But there is a limit on the number of times the adversary can do this, alpha sub k, m times out of from a horizon of n units. And the question, and there is a certain performance index that the controller would want to minimize. And of course, when alpha is zero, the controller does not have any cost on its control. And then one is looking for a saddle point solution in this case. So you are looking for a saddle point solution, meaning that the controller wants to minimize this quantity and the expected value of this, and the adversary wants to maximize this quantity. So this is one example of a situation where the links can be broken, and I'm not going to go into because of time. One can use Isaac's equation. Isaac is someone who developed Rufus Isaac's the dynamic programming in the context of differential games in the 1950s, alongside Bellman. They were both at the Rand Corporation at the time, and so using Isaac's one can come up with a threshold. So the question here is for the jammer looks at the state, and then if this state exceeds a certain threshold, X, that breaks the link. If it falls below that threshold, does not break the link. And there are other multidimensional cases of this. This is again with a former student and a colleague of mine. So the message to be taken here in this context is that which is in opportunistic sensing control and decision making, is that the limitations on usage, that they lead to event-driven actions. So what is the event? In this case, the event is what is that threshold mechanism provides an event, whether something exceeds a certain threshold or whether it falls below a certain threshold. But these thresholds are affected by the actions, by the past actions. So these are different, these class of problems are different from those where the events are exogenously generated. For example, you look at the weather. If it rains, you'll do something. If it doesn't rain, you won't do what you were planning to do. But that is not affected by the decision that you make in the past. Okay, whereas in these problems, the actions actually drive the events, which in turn drive the actions. So another class of problems is this. This is what I had earlier. This is control of information spread, and particularly the breaking of links by the adversary. So here I want to talk about very briefly, and this is a network problem, a distributed averaging, which is a robust distributed averaging problem. First, let me think of it as we have a graph with vertices, nodes, V, and a collection of edges, M links. There are M links, One algorithm, and the goal is the agents exchange information with their neighbors, and then they do averaging. So each node has a real valued variable, and the ultimate goal is to find the average of all these. So each node has a real number, and we want to find the average of these. You have there are several algorithms which will lead to the average value, and one of them is this continuous time algorithm, and A is a connection matrix of the graph, where if Aij is equal to is one, then you have the two nodes are connected, I and j. If it is zero, then I and j are not connected, and I'm missing and not belonging to E there. So So the average value of the x0 are the initial values, that's a vector. And so you want to compute the sum of the average value of these initial vectors. And this algorithm actually does it. If the graph is connected, one can show that the limit as t goes to infinity of x of t goes to this average value. So this is also called consensus, because all nodes agree on the average value. And there are algorithms which try to make this in the fastest possible time, and so on. So what we are interested in is we want to bring in an adversary, and the adversary breaks some of these links. So if they break some of these links, then the neighbors cannot exchange the information, the average information. So one model that captures this is one where the A matrix is modified, is perturbed in the following way. This is the adversary. So if Uij is 1, then that link is broken. If Uij is equal to 0, it's not broken. And again, this is a problem with that there are resource limitations. The adversary cannot break at any point in time more than k links out of possible m, and k is much smaller than m. And then designer does is designer increases the weights. If you increase the weight, then you are able to improve the convergence. So the Vij is that of the designer's control, and that's an either 0 or B. 0 means that you don't interfere, you don't inject anything into these ways, and B is when you do. So both U and V are piecewise continuous on 0T, and this results to leads to a matrix A, which is the negative Laplacian of the graph G. So one thing that one has there are so the question is, you want to minimize the performance, or you want to the designer wants to make the best possible, speed up the convergence, and the adversary, by breaking appropriate links, wants to decelerate that, and maybe even force convergence to a different value and not the average value. So one has to assume that there is this Zeno behavior. You should not allow for either the adversary or the designer to switch infinitely often. So you put some restrictions on the minimum dwell time on these. Otherwise, it leads to Zeno behavior. And then the objective function in this case is a weighted L2 norm of the difference between x, which is the at any point in time what the values at different nodes are, minus the average value. So we have formulated this for different types of under different assumptions. One is the passive designer. The designer doesn't do anything. We want to see what is the worst the adversary can do in order to prevent consensus. So the adversary wants to maximize this quantity. And there are two types of attacks the adversary can do. It can inject an interfering signal. This is not what I had in the original formulation. So that is the interfering signal. Or the adversary can break at most k links, as I had earlier. So the solution. It turns out that this problem has a solution. We can find out exactly what are the, given the resource constraints of the adversary, what is the worst that the damage that the adversary can do. It turns out that the optimal strategy for the adversary, so this is an optimal control problem for the adversary. The optimal strategy is to apply maximum power along the direction of the costate variable. So this was a nice interpretation. This is a nice interpretation. The second one is the one where the adversary breaks k links. And it turns out that in that case, the K links that the adversary will have to break are the ones which have these maximum Wij values. You look at the difference between Xi, the value at the ith node, the value at the jth node, and then the weighting, the which was the Aij, multiplying that, that's the entry, corresponding entry of the A matrix. And you look at those values, the adversary looks at those values, and then orders them, and then breaks the K links where those values are maximum. And this has a nice interpretation in terms of the power that's dissipated over link ij. And you can see in this problem that we have the adversarial network as well as non-adversarial network. The dotted ones is the non-adversarial network where you have nice convergence. And in this case, with the capabilities of the adversary, the convergence is to a different point. So, one can actually show that there exists an existence there. Some of the papers are, again, this is recent work with another student of mine who is now former, graduated in December, and it's all in his thesis, who also looked at epidemics problems, the spread of epidemics, and it has nice nonlinear models, and one has to look at stability of these things. In the problem of epidemics, the question is, do you have a steady state? Where does the, if there is a steady state, where does the network end up at? Which nodes are permanently infected, which ones are not, and so on. So there are some interesting results. I don't have time to go into this. And then another co-author there. And finally, I know that I'm running late, is just briefly, this is the last application. This is communication jamming in teams versus teams that I, this is the, in the information of UAVs and AGVs, aerial ground vehicles, as well as the unmanned aerial vehicles. And so I already motivated this problem that this is a network problem where you have the nodes are mobile, and this is a slide which I had earlier. So this has applications, this connectivity maintenance. The agents, when they are mobile, they have to stay within a certain communication range of each other, and so that arises information control, mobile sensor networks, rendezvous problems, as well as the flocking. So what the way you approach this problem, you have to have some dynamics for individual agents. The jammers here, this is the dynamics of the jammers. These are the jammers in this scenario. These are the friendly vehicles. They want to have a formation, and the network is again modeled as a graph. Initially, they are all connected. Through different, they are not, it's not a strongly connected graph, but a connected graph. So it's a dynamic graph because the edges move. Nodes move, but also the edges move. Some of them edges move in the sense that the number of edges actually can drop if the communication is lost between two of the edges. So this is the one that were the jammers. I have some animation here. Again, the vehicles want to try to maximize the time for which the network remains connected, and the jammers try to minimize that time. So the solution process is we use here, it's a zero-sum problem. This is a persuadivation game framework. And what is the termination time? The termination time is defined as the loss of connectivity. Once the connectivity is lost between the vehicles, then you have essentially the game ends. So that's the ending scenario. And the way to translate this into mathematics is you look at the Laplacian of the graph, and it should have the game ends when it has a Fiedler value zero. So second smallest eigenvalue. The smallest one is zero. So this is a termination condition for the state variables, and you can details can be found in this 2012 edited volume with Suha Bhattacharya. This was the work. He was a postdoc working with me, now a faculty member at Iowa State. So so let me just share, leave you with this animation, and I have one more. So you can see that in the aerial vehicles, the network gets disconnected in about 29 seconds, and then and this is the these are the dynamics. This is how the UAVs move and are controlled, and this is the ones for the AGVs. Okay, and then this is you can formulate. We looked into another problem, which we call double-sided jamming. The adversary's goal is not only to jam or to disconnect the ground vehicles, but also they don't want to lose the connection among themselves. So whereas the ground vehicles jam the adversarial fleet, and it wants to disconnect that. So this is what we call double-sided jamming, and you can see that at some point the UAVs in this case get disconnected, the communication range, at some point the others. So these problems can be formulated. So my last slide is multi-agent networks is really loaded with challenging issues. There's sensing, control, communication, coordination, trust, the adversarial action, jamming, and resilience issues. Resilience means gracefully the system can recover from a failed state. And I have discussed these issues of how to transmit, when to transmit, the timing of decisions, and control and intervene and disrupt and jam when there is only a limited number of opportunities and when there are limited resources. And the mobility brings in complications to this problem. And where you have these primary tasks of formation and connectivity, and the secondary objective of jamming. Now, these are related to some security issues. Also, we have again with Tansu Alpchan, another former student of mine. We wrote a Cambridge University Press book where we discuss the game theoretic approach to network security, and in a decision theoretic framework, and I just want to show this in case there is interest in looking into some of the security issues in these cases. So the network multi-agent systems with elements of game theory, this is my bottom line, and this emerging, there's the so-called network science, which is emerging, and there's a lot of interest in developing a science for networks, or network science. This is quite a fertile area of research, and I find the returns to be quite promising. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Either from Pittsburgh.
Well, this is wonderful. So many issues here. Specifically on ground vehicles, autonomous ground vehicles. If we consider the scenario, the current one is we have one Google car going around, and yes, that's I will claim it's easy. Now think about the penetration of, say, 50-60%. Forget for a moment adversarial behavior, but how do we propose modeling those cars that certainly there is some team aspect, the platoons, but certainly those roles are not necessarily aligned with the cars on the road. Then you have the also cars emerging from the other highways. Have you considered the modeling of all that? I'm trying to bring.
These are not part of the teams. These other cars that are coming. I can one extreme view would be view them as adversarial within some restrictions. With some restrictions. My view to these problems, when there is an uncertainty, like in this case of cars, they are operating in a. They want to accomplish a certain mission. You have a certain number of AGVs, and then you have other disturbances. That's what I see it as, disturbances. So if there is a statistical model for that, for these disturbances, then you can use the statistical model. But if not, there is nothing wrong with making the assumption that these are adversarial, even though they may not be adversarial, but using the information that you have, online information that you have on them. And so therefore that restricts the negative impact of the adversary. The more you confine the adversary, the more you know about the intentions or about the operating guidelines for the adversary, the better performance that you would get among the friendly. In this case, what you have to do is you have to have if it's totally decentralized, there is no way you can avoid this inefficiency of nationality. But if you have some additional, maybe infrequent, centralized information that is sent to these vehicles, then they can adjust. So this infrequent centralized information will improve the communication capabilities, will improve the content of the information that they receive about the states of other agents. And the other thing is, there are examples of this, but with stationary nodes, where when you as long as the network is connected, when you interact with your neighbors only, then that interaction propagates across the network. So it is as though you are interacting with all the agents on the network. So that this and this distributed averaging problem, which I discussed, and the robust distributed averaging problem is one such scenario where you only exchange, I have a certain value, the my neighbors have some other values, and then I look at my neighbors, and then I take the average of what they have. They do the same thing, and then but agent B may have a different set of neighbors, and so does the averaging with those neighbors. As long as the network is connected, then that you can stabilize, you can go to a consensus, essentially, which avoids Nash equilibrium, even though each one is operating under its own selfish interest, as long as they are not adversarial.
Any other questions?
Slight follow-up to Rodolfo's question. Can you go back to your last, the ground vehicle example, just your one or two slides before? Yeah, the model Yes.
Oh, this one.
Yeah, yeah, this one. So in extending the models, I assume, you know, to maybe more realistic, is so these velocities here are constant, is that correct?
The velocities are constant, yes. Okay. But this is three dimensional, as you can see.
Right.
The UAVs are three dimensional. There are three states, X, Y, Z, and then the AGVs are two dimensional.
Has there been any work in extending this type of formulation where you have UAV, AGV, but with, you know, variable velocities? Because you can imagine many different types of solutions if the velocities also can be adjusted.
Well, the optimal control actually approach, or the differential game approach, does allow, because those are your control variables in the right, the velocities. So they do allow, and we do in the paper itself, we do allow these velocities to be determined to the saddle point solution of the perceived evasion game.
And then to model disturbance, I mean, so this is without disturbance.
You are playing a game. UAVs are playing a game against AGVs.
Right.
And so this is a perceived evasion game. So the disturbance is not an exogenous input, but it's an input that is determined by an intelligent adversary. And what it does is the way it inputs this into the AGVs, the UAVs, is that if they are within a certain range of the ground vehicles, of two ground vehicles, then they can jam. So we have a jamming model which I did not have here, but it's in the paper, and so it is directly proportional to the distance, or some power of the distance, and if as the UAVs come closer to the median of the distance between two, or the mean of the distance between two vehicles, then they can jam that, and that connection is lost there. But then there could be a connection between, let's say that you have three vehicles, you between A and B you could lose a connection, but between B and C you could still have a connection, between A and C you could have a connection, so that's still a connected network, and so the game ends when one of the vehicles is completely isolated, in terms of, in other words, you have one node which has absolutely no edges in the graph, and so that's what I formulated as the termination condition, which is the Laplacian of the graph, which is time varying, becoming the Fiedler value. Becoming zero, the second smallest item. That's when the connectivity breaks down.
I will maybe the follow up. I mean, in this problem, one can say perhaps losing one vehicle is not that big of a problem, right? If you have too many vehicles, did you consider also the problem of ending the game when there is two big chunks that are isolated, that are not connected to each other?
We have not specifically formulated it that way, but there is no reason why one cannot. You just change the termination condition.
Okay.
Instead of the Fiedler value becoming zero, you look at the third smallest eigenvalue, fourth
okay.
smallest eigenvalue.
Okay, let's stop here and take other questions offline. Thank you very much again.
Thank you.